like to call the January 22nd school committee meeting to order. Been a couple weeks, I guess we, well, we got snowed out the last meeting, so I'm glad that's all melted. Happy to see Mr. Nyan, or Dr. Nyan, back. Welcome back.
Thank you, good to be back.
And Dr. Doxer is unavailable to be here tonight. So tonight, we're gonna, the big part of the meeting will be a review of the communication audit, which we had, we've been talking about for several months now. I think they interviewed us back in September or October, so we look forward to that report. And then an update on the Birch Meadow principal search. And then, anything on the Parker tonight, or?
I will give an update in my reports on Parker, yes.
And several field trips and donations. Before we get into the budget report.
Yeah.
Before we get into that, we could start with public input, if there is any, for anything that's not on the agenda. And from that, yes?
I saw that,
Can you just, do you mind coming up to the microphone, please? Thank you.
I saw in the packet that there's a subcommittee for starting school later, so that was one thing.
Yeah, oh, yes.
I wasn't sure if that was gonna be.
Yes. We are gonna discuss, I apologize, I didn't mention it.
No.
We are gonna discuss that as well. Thank you. And so we'll go into reports now. I'm a little, we've been off for a few weeks, I'm a little out of tune here. Going to reports. Alex, did you have a report?
Yeah, so on March 4th, 5th, and 6th, the Drama Club is putting on The Nerd at high school. Also, lately, the student council has been organizing a lip dub for all the different groups at the high school to participate in. Last week was February vacation, so today was our first day back. And course selection was due last week, and the guidance counselors have been meeting with students individually to talk about our schedules for next year. Robotics is hosting a North Shore event in the field house on March 12th and 13th, where they'll be competing against a bunch of other teams, and the robot looks awesome. And Chorus will be playing laser tag this Friday. That's it.
All right. So tomorrow at the high school, it's Future Freshman Night. Mrs. Skian was talking to me about that. Apparently, the fire curtain is down in the auditorium. Have we heard about that?
Yes.
Yes.
All right. So hopefully that won't affect the play, the nerd that's going on at Mr. RMHS, which is, I believe, in a month. Some winter sports happenings. The boys swim team finished 10th at the States with 8 swimmers. The girls hockey team won the Middlesex League. The boys hockey team is a big week this week with a game tonight against 5th-ranked Burlington, then a game Wednesday against 1st-ranked BC High. So if they're able to do well, they will probably qualify for the Super 8, which is a big deal for hockey kids. At track, we had Paul Chong, who he's a great student, also great track athlete. He finished 1st in the high jump, 1st in the broad jump, and 2nd in hurdles, which is very impressive. Chris Doncaster finished 3rd in the shot put. And basketball, boys basketball team has an upcoming tournament game with the time and place to be determined. That's all.
Great, thank you. Gary, did you
order? Nothing really.
I wanted to mention tomorrow night's Board of Selectmen meeting. I know it's, I believe, has it been moved to Parker? I was trying to look it up and then I forgot.
Oh,
it's
not.
I believe
yeah,
it has.
Yeah,
it has been moved to Parker because part of the discussion, I think they say in the agenda that's going to happen after 9 o'clock would be talk of the potential override. Mm-hmm. So that's, you know, for people that are interested to come out and to attend that meeting, I think it would be great. The more people, the better.
What is that again?
Tomorrow night.
I think it's 9:15, it's on the agenda for.
Correct.
For 9:15.
And this specifically says override discussion or just the budget?
It's an ongoing discussion about the process.
Okay.
I don't have anything.
Okay, I said I would read Dr. Dox's report, so I'll do that now. She had a few reports, the RMHS drama Around the World in 80 Days. I think that was mentioned over here. She says many thanks to visiting director Bill Enslow, I guess was in for that, and the drama club for their inspiring production. I am so proud of the drama and arts nurtured and celebrated in our district, and thank our talented educators, parents, and students, along with all of the generous donations from community businesses who make support the arts in Reading. And then she had the CPAC report. Last week's CPAC meeting was a very helpful blend of presentations, administration, and advice. The presentations by Pupil Services Director Carolyn Wilson and Kelly DeCato, Extended School Year Coordinator, were very informative. They illuminated the process involved in planning the Special Education Summer Extended School Year Program, as well as the transitions between grades and buildings for each student. The information presented reflected consideration of both feedback and input from parents, along with the communication of realistic expectations for each program. The questions of parents were informed, caring, and thoughtful, reflecting parents' desire to collaborate with the program for the benefit of their children. Parents were encouraged to share their specific concerns with their IEP teams and team chairs. You can find copies of the PowerPoint presentations on Edline. The meeting ended with the ratifying of the updated CPAC bylaws, a labor of love and a lot of time invested by the CPAC bylaw subcommittee. A huge shout out goes to the parents working together to bring the CPAC back to life. I feel honored to be the liaison to this committee of involved parents and staff with whom they work. That has been a while. That's good.
Human Relations Advisory Committee. Next meeting is on Tuesday, March 3rd. It will be a continuation of discussions related to the mission, bylaws, and history of the committee. Everyone is welcome. If you're interested in attending the Metco Lobby Day on March 15th, Tuesday, at the State House, it starts at 9, and please contact Jason Cross, Reading Metco Director, for more information. Submitted Linda Doxter. Do you want to pass that over?
I did want to also mention what Election Day is Tuesday. Julie and I had our interviews the other night, but no, it's get out and vote. I'm sure there'll be plenty of people out for the primary.
I just have Tuesday is March 2nd. Is that right?
March 1st.
March 1st, because we have a leap. We have a leap year this year, so.
Okay, so Wednesday, March 2nd is the Taste of Metro North.
Correct.
Which is actually in North Reading.
North Reading High School, yep.
But that's the Reading Rotary, and of course the Rotary is one of the nonprofits and foundations in the community that supports the schools, one of the many, but a very important one. So I encourage folks to vote on Tuesday and go to Taste of Metro North on Wednesday.
My 25th anniversary.
I don't know if I would do that.
Yeah, I don't know if I'd bring a little taste of it.
We'll give Chuck a buy. I'll buy a ticket and give it to someone.
Okay. Carol, did you?
Just to add, we did have a CPAC meeting. It was well attended. We had about 20 parents in attendance. Also, team chairs came out to represent the different schools. We talked with parents about our extended school year program and what the offering and the program will look like for this summer so people can start to make their plans. And then we discussed the building-to-building transitions and how we are working with families and with staff as students with IEPs transition from one grade level to the next. So I think overall it went very well. The CPAC is planning a lot of different events, so I'm excited about what their interests are and what the rest of this year will look like.
So. Thank you.
I only have the financial update, which is part of the agenda.
Okay.
Just very briefly, I'll give an update about our annual Blue Ribbon Institute, which is scheduled for Friday, April 15th. We have sent out information to other districts across the state, actually getting a lot of responses very quickly. Our keynote speaker that morning is Dr. George Sugai, who is probably best known as being one of the top national leaders in PBIS, the Positive Behavioral Interventions and Supports, MTSS. And I think he's actually gotten some interest, or he's raised the interest of a lot of other districts, I think, in the state to come. So we're looking forward to seeing him and being a part of that day.
Oh, great.
So I'll give you more information as we start putting the agenda more together and getting specifics about the presentations and workshops and stuff.
Yeah, it's funny with the weather. It feels like we're coming off of spring vacation and not February, but it's still only February.
Yeah.
Dr. Daugherty.
I have a few things. First, the Packer update, and I had sent something out to the community yesterday. So we began the search with 47 applications, which is a significant amount. This is a very talented pool that had applied for this principalship. Screening committee met prior to vacation. I met individually with all of the people that they move forward. Tomorrow we are going to be announcing 4 finalists for the position. Those finalists will be coming to Parker on next Monday, a week from today, February 29th. They'll spend a little bit of time in the school during the day. They'll be getting interviewed by students, the district leadership team, taking a tour of the classrooms, doing a classroom observation, and then giving me feedback on what they saw in that observation. And then in the afternoon after school, they'll be having an open microphone session with staff. And then that evening, beginning at 6:30, they'll have an open microphone session with the community. So all are welcome to attend that session on the 29th that's starting at 6:30. So it'll go 6:30 to 8:30.
Just a question about the students meeting with the candidates. Will the same students be meeting with all candidates?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes. I met today with Jane Villadennis and Brendan Norton to come up with the schedule. And yes, we're going to have a mix of 6th, 7th, and 8th grade students that will meet with all 4 candidates.
Great. Okay.
So once that's done, you'll then do site visits?
So at that point, I'll make a determination whether I need to do site visits to their schools or I can appoint someone at that point. So my hope is that by mid-March, that search will be completed. Any questions on that? The Birch Meadow search is just starting to enter the application phase. The application's deadline is this Friday. We've received so far 21 applications. My guess is that'll pick up in the next few days. But still, that's a strong number. The screening committee, which you have in your packet tonight, has been chosen. They had their first meeting today. They will be meeting next week to design questions, and the interviews are scheduled, I believe, for March 7th. So it'll follow a similar timeline as the Parker search. So that that's on that search. I do want to talk a little bit about some facilities pieces. So as you know, 2 weekends ago, we had a lot of cold, really bitter cold. We did We did have some ice issues, but they were minimal. Our facilities department was right on top of things. We did have one pipe on the rooftop at the Coolidge multipurpose room burst, or it was a coil, it wasn't even a pipe, which created some water damage, which we got taken care of. We did have a couple of other issues. One here was at the high school, but it was caught in time before a pipe burst here, and one at Birch Meadow. So we had minor damage, but it will all be put in as one claim through Maya. We've already looked into that. So kudos to the facilities department for staying on top of things last weekend, because it could have been a... I know there were some schools that actually had to close today, because they still had not cleaned up all the damage from the pipe burst in other districts. So so we had minimal damage.
What about the town buildings? So they...
I honestly, I do not know. I'm sorry, I do not know the answer to that.
Can I ask a follow-up on that?
Sure.
So this is probably the first time since the reorg of facilities that there's been this kind of a, I don't want to say crisis, but a situation, mm-hmm. an urgent situation. How did it go? How did
It went fine. I meet weekly with Joe. In fact, I sometimes talk to him 2-3 times a day. So, no, the communication's been excellent. There's been no issues with the move to a core
structure.
Department.
Thanks. I just wanted, so very early in the year, there was a weekend storm and nothing, this didn't get taken care of very well, but Joe since then had said, you know, part of the thing that he did is make sure that the schedule, probably from talking to you, make sure that the facilities department is, you know, well aware of the schedule so that if there's an event going on a Saturday mm-hmm. and the snowstorm is, you know, Friday night, you know, you don't have till 10 o'clock on Saturday morning. You got to have it cleared by 7 on Saturday because there's an event. So he did say that he sort of tightened that up and did some belt and suspenders on
that. Yeah, I think it was during vacation week. It was during vacation week, and I think it was a communication issue with DPW. There was some misunderstanding with DPW about what needed to be plowed during vacation week.
Back in December, so
right.
Anyway, but that was good.
And the only other thing I want to mention is that our next school committee meeting, we've got a whole team of people that are going to be doing various presentations around the topic of MTSS. So Sarah Bird, Sarah Machant, Heather Leonard, and some other staff are going to be talking about various aspects of MTSS at different levels and some of the Tier 1 supports and programs that we've put in place. So that's really the only topic that evening, but it's going to be a meaty one. I think you'll see that there'll be a lot of good information that night.
Great. Okay, now we have the, we have a motion.
Yes, move to approve the consent agenda as presented.
Second.
For a second. All those in favor? 5-0. Actually jump out. You want to do the update on the late?
Sure.
Late start, that way you don't have to hang around.
Sure. So in your packet there is a memo about the formation of a late start committee. In previous school committee meetings we've had conversations about how that there's been continuing and emerging research out there about starting middle and high schools at a later start time. Because of the biological clock of a young adolescent and how that can affect stress and anxiety and learning and a variety of factors. A couple months ago, the Middlesex League superintendents came up with an agreement that we would all be pursuing over the next few years to go to later start times at all of our high schools. Right now, Reading Memorial High School is at 7:30, which is actually one of the earliest out of all of the Middlesex Leagues for start time for high schools. So to that end, we're going to be putting together a committee of really a variety of stakeholders, which you can see here consisting of a member of the school committee. It's a 21-member community committee, which is a large committee, but I think it's important to have all of the voices that are on this list heard as we answer the questions that, you know, about the implementation of a possible late start. So be a member of the school committee. There'd be four administrators, one from each level, one from the district level. The director of community education, which would be involved with our before-school programs. Administrator from the recreation department, which is going to certainly be involved in youth sports and fields, and because we've had some conversation already about that. Teacher representation, as well as the Reading Teachers Association president or designee, and I've already talked to Chris about that. Member of the Board of Health. Remember, the Board of Health sent us a letter probably a year and a half ago now in support of having a later start at the high school level. Two students, one for middle school and one for high school. Director of METCO, because obviously busing for METCO and activities for METCO would be affected by this. Three parents, one from each level. A representative from the business community, a representative from the Reading Police Department, because obviously school safety will be a part of this conversation, and Reading, a representative from our CASA. I've asked Craig and Lena Williams, the director of guidance, to co-chair the working group. I think it's important to have the director of guidance a key part of this, since they deal every day with the social emotional piece of our students, and Lena, I know, will help facilitate, and Craig will help facilitate a strong process. The group is going to take a look at a variety of factors, including the research behind changes in start times, the impact on the start times on all three levels, if we do have to make changes at all three levels or just one or two, the impact on the activities before and after school, which include athletics, extracurricular, jobs, community activities, impact on staff, impact on bus transportation. I mean, one of the advantages we do have in this district is we do not have a lot of bus transportation, whereas other school districts do. But we still need to take a look at what that impact will be. Early release day schedules, the impact on staff who may be taking courses after school, building rentals, and any fiscal implications for the district. The timeline is that we will start advertising to get parents and teachers to apply to be a part of the committee. I will go to the different other groups and ask for representatives. This committee will meet from March through October. They'll make a presentation to the school committee. We'll have, I'm assuming, some public hearings on it. And then the school committee will decide in either November or December on what the changes in times will be. Your policy indicates that this is a school committee decision. The reason why we want to have this timeline ending in December, so that if changes are going to be made for the 17-18 school year, that we want to make sure people have plenty of notice. It would be 9 months notice if they have to make any arrangements.
So, John, why shouldn't the athletic director be on there? I know that
he'd be one of the four administrators.
Yeah, but I think that this will have an impact on athletics. So, what if he isn't one of the four what if they decide on somebody? I think that person should be at the table,
no matter what.
So
you're saying to add him to make a 22nd member,
or we just say it's him as the administrator? Sure. But then again, I don't know whether that means you. Maybe we want Adam there. I don't know. I mean, that's. Yeah. I guess we got to figure. Sure. Maybe we should talk about that. But I definitely think that it will have a major, I mean, we'll have the big impact on, as you said, after school, And it, but it will have on practice time and all that stuff, and you would want the athletic director to weigh in.
He was going to be one of the four administrators.
Okay. Okay.
So, yes, I had every intention.
So he's that, the, by default, the...
The high school.
At that level, the high, yeah.
I had every intention of having him on.
I'm sorry, any other? Yes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. So I just, thinking about this timeline, thinking about, we've been talking about some things that we might do at the high school or on schedule and just different ideas. And I, so I'm just thinking it would be good to, I don't know, to make sure that each knew about both, you know, that you had things sort of in process and were aware, and they might, and this, well, especially the administrators, to the administrators, that might matter, and there's some changes that we might make that might facilitate this kind of a shift. So you think it'll all be sort of churning at the same time?
Yes.
Okay. Thank you.
Did you have some?
No, I just was wondering what Mrs. Webb was alluding to about, I wasn't quite sure whether it was the calendar per se or...
No, not the calendar, but we've had, over the past few months, there's been
some...
There
were several committees going on at the high school to take a look at things like the schedule, the graduation requirements, the program of study. So I think that's what...
That's what I'm talking
that's
about.
That's what she's talking
yeah.
about.
Yeah.
Did you have... Did you?
Yeah.
Come on up. Thank you.
I'm Dr. Jessica Kaufman. I'm a professor of biotechnology and bioengineering at Endicott College, and I have two little kids in the town at Killam who are in kindergarten and third grade, so they have a long time before they have to wake up at 7:30. But I thought that this is probably a long process, and maybe if people start to think about it now, they won't have to wake up at 7. Well, I think the problem is they don't really wake up at 7:30, right? Like, if you're a girl in high school and you want to get ready in the morning and have a little bit of time, or if you have the crazy idea of eating breakfast before a test, right, you're probably waking up at 6:30 or earlier. So I looked into starting a Start School Later chapter for Reading. I had talked to the national group, and I found out that the Reading high school doctor, so I guess the person who writes the prescriptions for the town, Frank Brochero, he had actually started the Start School Later chapter in Melrose, where he lives. And so I think that might be a resource for this issue. But I just wanted to come because I wanted to be able to be on the committee or, you know, be involved and figure out what's happening and support the effort, because I think it's important and it makes a difference. I mean, I just know in my own teaching, I see, like, 8 a.m. and 10 a.m. It's a very different experience. I don't think the college students are developmentally that much different than high seniors in high school.
Yep.
So, yeah, that's it.
So you can just, we'd love to have you on. Just send an email.
Yeah, I'll send you an email.
Great, thank you.
Thank you.
All right, thank you so much.
And I know we send a lot of kids to Endicott, so.
Yeah.
Let's see. Want to do the communication?
Sure.
Got it.
So you have read the 86-page report. I will try to take what was in the report and summarize it on several slides here. But I look at this as the beginning of a process on how we can improve what we're currently doing with communication in the Reading Public Schools. I think we do a lot of things with communication. What we need to start doing is figuring out how do all the pieces come together and the process that we use and how do we use communication smarter. And that was really what I got out of the report. I got a lot of good ideas and tips on how we can make things better. Some of these things we're already starting to look at. So during this presentation, I'll talk a little bit more about that. The goal of the whole audit was to assess what we currently are doing and get feedback from stakeholders, take a look at existing documents that we use, and suggest how can we do things better. We brought in the national NSPRA to take a look at how we were doing it. And if you remember, they came in on October 5th and 6th, and they conducted 10 focus group interviews. One was with the school committee, but we also had other focus groups, parents, PTO, school council, various staff, the business and community, district administrators, to name, and teachers, to name a few. Basically, what the NSPRA, the National School Public Relations Association, looked at is how can we create a planned, systemic way of improving what we do in our school district? How do we get that information out? How do we make communication proactive and two-way with the community? They very much talked about throughout this entire process is a way to start talking about the things that we're doing, branding the Reading Public Schools, getting ahead of the message so that we can talk about the good things that are going on, to talk about also the problems that are going on and how we can address them. And it came out loud and clear from the different stakeholders. The assumption that we're using here is that using this audit is going to help improve what we're currently doing. Unless we have that information, we can't really change. And that although perceptions may or may not be real, they are strong indicators of what people feel right now and what the gaps are. And I think that's important. So they did, and it was good to see that a lot of the things that came up in this were also connected to some of the things I found out last spring when I was doing the community forums. But they did also ask questions about the strengths of the Reading Public Schools and certainly the quality of education, the dedication of staff, the culture of openness and responsiveness. And they talked about the fact that we were doing this survey is an indication, this audit is an indication that we are open and responsive to feedback, and that there is a lot of parent and community support in this community. Some of the challenges that came out with the focus groups were concerns about financing and budgeting, which I think we all now know or have been aware of, that there is a very high level expectation for quality programs. And the audit does mention that sometimes the expectations may be unrealistic and too high for the resources that we have available. And that we do have parents and stakeholders that are very engaging, and how do we get that message out there in a proactive way? Some of the strengths about communication was the interpersonal communication between leaders and stakeholders, it was listed. The building level communication between principal and the community and teachers in the community, that there's a level of transparency and commitment with the school committee and the superintendent, and the amount of electronic and social media communication that we have in this district. And they cited many of the types of electronic communication that we use, ranging from the two newsletters to Twitter and Facebook in our Connect Ed. Some of the challenges is that we really don't have a coordinated plan and a strategic policy on communication. We do have bits and pieces of policies, and the school committee does have policies, one you just reviewed recently on communication. The outreach that we have with community members, that we do have a lot of opportunities for the community to give feedback, and the forums is one example, but there's still gaps in that. That there's a perception sometimes from what's coming in and the feedback that we're hearing. And Edline came up a lot in this audit with the difficulty with the use, not only on the user end of teachers, but on the community end with parents. So those are all challenges that came up.
John, how long have we had Edline now?
We had Edline when I was a principal at Coolidge, so it's probably 12, 13, 14 years. And at the time when it came out, Edline was on the cutting edge of what we were using, and it connected very well with Administrators Plus, which is our student information management system. But over time, like with any technology, there's been a lot of new products out there that are much more integrated. And Rediker or Administrators Plus actually has their own line of products now, which they do not. EdLine belongs to Blackboard Connect, which is actually our Connect Ed also. So there's over time, there's been that integration issue, whereas now Rediker has their own whole suite of programs that, so it's you know, those are the types of things we need to take a look at and see what's available.
Yes,
But is it, I guess we need to look at, but is part of it that we could do some, you know, you have to look at whether you do some more improvement or upgrading in EdLine to have it work the way that you want it to work, or whether you have to sort of reset? Is that sort of?
It's possible it could be a reset, yes. And we've started looking at some other web-based programs that are out there and what they have to offer. You know, teachers have a whole list of concerns, mostly around the grade book piece, the EdLine piece from their end. And I know that the parents have their set of concerns as well from the usability piece. So, you know, those are the types of things we're looking at, is what types of, and from my perspective, I want to minimize the amount of external products that we use. I'd rather have one that's an integrated solution as much as possible. So those are the types of things that we're starting to look at, is do we have a more integrated solution out there that can do more things? Right now, GradeQuick is a separate program. AP Web, which is the elementary version of GradeQuick, is a separate program. EdLine is a separate program. The program that we use for special education,
SEMStracker,
thank you, is a separate program. So Baseline Edge, which is our teacher evaluation piece, is a separate program. So is there a way that we can start integrating this all with Rediker or another product like Rediker, so it's all seamless? Because right now anytime you have these integration issues with transitions, that's when you tend to have breakdown.
Can I?
Yeah.
Well, I think the other thing that keeps happening now more than 10 years ago is, as each software company, they're flipping to new versions. And when they're doing that, they're not always keeping the level of, backward compatibility, too. Mm-hmm. So I think you can, when you have a lot of different products, you can get really caught up in that, you know, I you want to go here, but you can't because these other products, you know, won't match. I also think I would just say, as a student point of view, my, at least high school boys, never had as much problem with EdLine as I did. So, I think from a student, I don't know what the student feedback is. Maybe it could be better, but I think, at least my experience is, they're pretty adaptable and they sort of never really cared that much. They knew, like, here's where I got to go to get my stuff. So I probably would say that I probably would have rated it lower as a parent tool than the students. But
I think from a communication standpoint, all those other ones you mentioned are fine, but I look at those as internal.
Right.
And from a communication standpoint, the thing we should be focused on is EdLine, because that's how we're communicating to the parents. And, you know, 12 years ago, we were probably asking EdLine to do things now that we wouldn't even have thought it to 12 years ago, when we sent things home in the backpacks or whatever. And that's all being shifted to EdLine. So,
I just say, I think it is really important, though, that, like, though, all those internal issues, because that impacts the efficiency and function of our staff.
Right.
And so, you know, when we look at how we might have to prioritize, funding this improvement or transition, I think, you know, with it, we're not going to be able to do everything at once. So, and I really feel like we've got to make sure that those pieces are working well, because if that's not working well, then whatever you communicate outward isn't going to be, you know, as accurate. So,
well, it doesn't always mean more money, though.
No, it doesn't, and that's a very good point.
We're shifting. Paying for a different product,
right? Mm-hmm. And so, what we're looking at right now is, what is it that we're doing right now that we don't need to do anymore? How can we make things budget neutral and make some changes? Mm-hmm. And so, that's what we're looking at right now.
Sorry.
two thoughts on it. One is student privacy, data privacy.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm sure that's high on your list anyway, but just to throw, I didn't see it. So just to throw that out there, that that has to be a high priority. The other, Mr. Robinson just mentioned stuff coming home in the backpacks. That still happens surprisingly often. So it would be nice if we did go down the direction of implementing something new, of using it as an opportunity to say, and we're really going to look at every piece of paper we send home and really shift everything digital as much as possible and make that the expectation. Because there's been a lot of progress in that, but I think there's still a little ways to go. And that would save money, too.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Gary, did you?
Dr. Darty and I already had this conversation, but I just wanted to clarify that the EdLine was listed sort of like down at the bottom of the list, but that doesn't necessarily mean it's being done in that's not a priority. That's not a
it, yeah, the
not
order of the recommendations is not the priority of the recommendations.
Oh.
Right.
Great, thank you.
So the recommendations, the purpose of these recommendations, which I'll talk about in a minute, is to really improve and expand what we're currently doing and address ways for us to develop a program that addresses the needs of all the stakeholders. We want to build on what we're currently doing. We want to use the resources that we have available. If we can make it budget neutral, in which I you know, I'm confident that we can make a lot of changes without any increase to the budget. That's really the goal. We also want to make sure that our staff understand that we are all ambassadors for the Reading Public Schools. And they mentioned this in the audit, which I think is an important point, is that whoever you are and your interactions with staff, with parents, with the community, you are an ambassador of the Reading Public Schools. So how you communicate is going to be absolutely critical. And this is what Dr. Nyhan was talking about. What the National School Public Relations Association recommends is that you do 1 through 3 first to establish your foundation, then followed by 4 through 7. Recommendation 8 was really a fiscal issue, and it talks about adding a position that focuses solely on communication, or resources that focus solely on communication in the district. So that was more recommendation 8. But we are already starting to take a look at some of these recommendations that they have mentioned. So taking a look at the first recommendation, the first one is to develop a strategic plan. And with that, they talk about how, and right now we do have as goal 5 in our district improvement plan, in the communication piece. So it's really enhancing that action plan because we were waiting for this audit to come about before we came up with a full-fledged action plan on communication. They also discuss creating a communication advisory council, which would consist of all stakeholders, which would help develop this plan.
Is that like a working group?
It's like a working group, yeah.
Okay.
The second recommendation is to develop and adopt a school committee policy on communication. I have asked NSPRA to send me some sample policies, which they have started doing. You already have several policies that are communication related. So it may just be to take a look at those and revising them if necessary. One that you already did was the public input policy a couple months ago. But some of the topics that they list here are things that we already have in policy. But there's certainly things that we can continue to take a look at. The third recommendation is to expand the culture of communication in the school district, and what they're talking about this is to continue to build on the success of social media, the blog, the newsletters, things like that. But they were drilling down a little bit in those, like the newsletters, they were talking about in the information that's going out to parents, in the information that's going out to teachers, talk about how this issue affects them. Which is something we've started doing a little bit recently since we've gotten the report. They talk about using an action grid, which is in the next slide, which we've actually started using in our district leadership team, which talks about the agenda item, the action taken, the key discussion points, and how that's going to be communicated. When we're making decisions, come up with a rationale, explain the rationale behind that decision, creating key messages, and communicating regular updates on the status of goals and other issues. They also talk about, and I don't know if it's in this recommendation or another one, they talk about having a short summary written after every school committee meeting on what happened at that meeting and putting it in the newsletter, putting it in the blogs, so that people are updated on the key points of that school committee meeting. So here's an example of the action grid that they talked about in the audit. And again, this is something that we've already started using with our district leadership team meetings.
So can I just back up on that comment about the school committee? So what are right now we have an agenda that everybody sees, and then there's ultimately minutes produced mm-hmm. from the meeting. So what other than that are they?
I think it's just what they're saying is create a short summary, it's a paragraph or two about the things that were discussed and decided upon at the school committee meeting.
So that, but she just left. Isn't that something that we rely on the media to do?
We do. I think one of the things that they mentioned in the audit is that our parents are more relying on communication that's coming out from us or from other means like school Facebook pages or other things. And that, you know, since they're getting a lot of their information from us, putting that information out there would be important.
Yes.
Yeah. So I think, you know, maybe if there's something very small and tabular, but one of the balances, I think, sometimes you, about how much information you push out mm-hmm. versus invite people to fetch. And, you know, so whether, you know, after the school committee meeting, if the newsletters might just provide a link, right, to our information, but you're saying the feedback is to sort of summarize and try to capture why is this important to the parents?
That. Yeah, so for example, in my newsletter this past weekend, I put something in about the audit and why is this important to us? Mm-hmm. So I listed the recommendations. Here are some of the things that you know, we're going to be looking at. Edline is one of those things.
Right.
Things that would be meaningful to people.
So, sorry to...
That's okay.
So if we go back to that memo that we looked at about the makeup of the committee.
Yep.
We didn't have any... Maybe we should have somebody... I'm not trying to make a committee that... You know, that's too big, but maybe there should be somebody from the local media involved in that. I mean, they're communicating as well on our behalf. You know, maybe that, I don't know whether it's, you know, maybe they decide amongst themselves, but I mean, it is private enterprise, so they're theoretically competing against each other, so maybe, I don't know, I think we should reach out to them and let them, maybe they want to, and maybe they could offer some valuable input on this. I don't know, does anyone else disagree or agree with that? Or?
Well, I would think it's a good idea. The business community, was that an intention with regard to the business community, or that was just broad?
It was just broad.
Oh, okay. Because that could certainly be sort of a business community mm-hmm. member, could be the.
All right. Yeah. Sorry.
Chuck, the one problem I see with that is if we're asking the media to do a summary, we can't edit what they write. So then if they got something that was slightly incorrect, we're not reporting it, they are.
Yeah.
That would be my only hesitation.
I mean, it will be an important part of that committee, not to speak for Craig, but to send out, you know, ongoing communication about what is being discussed.
Yeah, maybe that's.
Yeah, and I think this issue to me isn't one of which one, but it's both, right? You, and somewhere in here, it specifically said developing and maintaining strong relationships with all the local media and having them be partners and getting as much information out as possible. So you want to do that. Then on the other hand, to your point, we also want to control the information we're getting out as much as possible. I don't think it's one or the other. I think it's both.
Right. They also talk about things involving our crisis communication and considering a district-wide survey, which I've also asked NSPRA to send me some samples, which they have sent me some already. Just on the crisis communication, which I forgot to mention in my report, but this is a good connection. On Wednesday and Thursday this week, I am going to be joining Lieutenant Jackson, Lieutenant Abadi, Officer Mulo, Joanne King, Eric Sprung, myself. We're going to be involved in a multi-hazard two-day safety training to take a look at our safety plans, to update them. DESE received a grant to provide regional workshops for school districts to work with their police and fire to update their safety plans. So on Wednesday and Thursday this week, we're going to be actually doing that very thing, so that you're aware of that. Recommendation four is to consider strategies and tactics to enhance internal communication. So they talk a lot about the interpersonal, the face-to-face communication, and how important that is. Creating expectations and guidelines for district administrators and principals and what they share out, what key messages and talking points are going to be shared out with staff. And with the community, they do mention in here that the impact that community Facebook pages do have in putting out messages that may not entirely be supported by data, and how it's important for us to get the message out there with the information that is relevant to and avoid any misperceptions or misconceptions. Want to make sure that secretaries are kept in the loop, a very key person in each building are our school secretaries, to make sure that they know what the key bullet points are. And making sure that we use strategy and activities to keep employees engaged and address any concerns they may have. And again, that can be done face-to-face. It's done at staff meetings. It's done in the weekly newsletter and other venues. Each school sends out their own newsletter, as well as the district sending out a newsletter. So there is a lot of information going out to staff. They also talk about under recommendation four is to offer professional development for staff in this area. One of the things that we do right now, and it's something we can expand upon, is as part of our new teacher induction program, we do talk about communication, the use of email with parents, what you should be saying, what you shouldn't be saying, the student privacy piece that Ms. Borowski brought up. Those are things we now do with our new teachers every year, and it's something we can expand upon with other staff. Recommendation five is to strengthen efforts to connect with and engage parents and other stakeholders. They talked about community forums, continuing to hold those opportunities for parents. To come up with a branding of what Reading Public Schools is all about and communicate that culture of excellence, marketing opportunities for parents, and inviting parents that have skill in this area to address communication challenges. They do also talk, and I believe it's in five, no, maybe it isn't, is to have ambassadors who we meet with on a regular basis to get the word out there, so that when there are misperceptions in different schools, that there are parents that can say, no, that's not the case. This is what is going on. So it's people out there that are carrying the message of what and being proactive about it. Some of the challenges that were discussed in recommendation five was the website, which we know, the elementary report card and understanding that. And as I mentioned earlier, proactive communication to forestall the spread of inaccurate information and rumors. And this is where the parent ambassadors can play a key role. Also in recommendation five, they talk about developing a key communicator network, which these ambassadors could be a part of. They talk about reaching out to families in the community that no longer have children attending the Reading Public Schools, which include empty nesters and senior citizens, making sure we have a good relationship with our media, the Chronicle they mentioned specifically, but other local media. And having a shadow day for community leaders, where community leaders come in and spend a day shadowing, say, a student going through their schedule, or what's a day like in an elementary student's lives, or a high school student's lives in the Reading Public Schools, so that they can get an understanding of what school is like. Recommendation six is the website recommendation, planning to upgrade and redesign, and we've already talked a lot about that, and that we certainly are looking at different options right now. And it really needs to be looked at, I feel, as an integrated solution. Starting with your student information management system, to the gradebook piece, to the communication piece, which is the what we have right now with ConnectEd, to your web page, and parent portals and student portals, which a lot of products now have, which we really don't have with our current setup. The other piece about this that I keep forgetting to mention is that whatever we decide to use also has to be compliant with the state, because we send a lot of data to DESE. So it has to be what's called SIF compliant, so that the information that's inputted in our student information management system goes to the state in a timely manner.
Let me guess, their system's probably 20 years old.
We've had some issues with the state system, shall we say. Yes. And then recommendation seven is to make more effective use of social media, which includes expanding what we're currently using and the content and how we're using it. Pretty much now, with the exception of maybe one or two schools, every school has a Facebook page and a Twitter and a web page. How it's being used is something that we need to develop more consistent guidelines for. But we are in the process of doing that. And then recommendation eight is formalizing the function and really exploring ways of creating a dedicated position. This is a budgetary issue. But they talked about some maybe short-term solutions, which could include giving stipends to teachers, granting release time, outsourcing it, looking at universities to see if there's internships that we could utilize on a short-term basis, those types of things. There are more and more school districts that are now hiring a position like this. They are more the bigger school districts, but more and more school districts are now do have this position, because it is such a critical role to play, communicating out, branding the school district, marketing the school district. That is something that is becoming more and more popular in
even at schools. Even at the public school level?
Yeah. And a lot of times it falls upon administrators' shoulders, you know, and it is a huge time commitment.
Yeah, I just one of the slides that talked about, you know, reaching out to other citizens, empty nesters, et cetera. I think that's really important. I don't think it doesn't take much more than like a year for the first year after your kids leave the high school. I think people are sort of connected, or they might try to stay connected, or maybe you're on some active parent things. It's still getting email, but then it's really disconnected quickly, and I think a lot of those people would like go to Taste of Metro North, would go to the performances, but aren't in that loop of, say, getting that kind of outreach. So I would think that that's a kind of outreach that could then continue to help keep people informed about what's going on here and keep them positively engaged in the schools. So, I don't, you know, that's down the road. But yeah, and I think that the that this concept is great, but I you know, I certainly see that it would offset impacts that currently that's shared across a lot of different administrators. And, you know, if you could do something with an intern or a co-op, you know, it's sort of cheaper money for that effort. But I think we have some, you know, I just think we have some core issues that have to come before something
right,
like this.
Right. So the next steps in the process is we're actually reviewing our district action plan goal 5 and revising it based on this report. Certainly this will be a multi-step process. Focusing first on the 1, 2, 3, and 5, 5 being the web page one. reviewing, you know, options to upgrade a current learning management system and website. If it's a budget neutral cost, it's certainly something we can entertain sooner than later. And offer community forums to present the audit, which I think is going to be important, is to present this to the community. I mean, we've put the audit out there as much as we can to the community, and, you know, offering opportunities to present and answer questions I think will be important as well, and to get more feedback. So that's the next steps early in the process. But we will continue to use this audit as a tool to help us move forward in this area.
Yes, Borowski.
I really appreciate this a lot. And I have to say, I've been on the committee for over 2 years now, and I think that this is an area that there has been tremendous improvement already in the last 2 years. So I think that the focus you've put and the team has put on this has paid dividends in terms of more proactive, more timely, comprehensive communication. So I think there's already been good progress made in this area. I'm concerned about budget is one thing, but then the resources and time that this would take. I mean, I imagine the professional development alone. You're not going to have teachers come into school and say, it's no longer the system you've been using for 12 years. It's something wholly new. I mean, every teacher in the whole district would have to be trained on this. And just, we just were talking about changing start times. There's a lot going on. Do you see something that's maybe ramping down that while this ramps up so that it's not so much of a strain on the staff?
Well, every year with technology your learning changes.
Yeah.
So right now, I'll just give you an example. Right now we are migrating to Office 365. And each building is getting migrated separately with their email system. Which isn't a big transition. Mostly it's with the issues we've had is more with the mobile devices than it is computers. So we are always transitioning. Baseline Edge, I actually was at a meeting today with several teachers about Baseline Edge, and they changed to HTML5 this year, which means the teachers had to learn that. They actually think it's a much better product than what we were using before when we had Baseline Edge. So we're always relearning technology. That's always going to happen in our lives. I think the teacher impact, it will be much more positive because what they're dealing with right now, and I use the gradebook program because that's the one I hear about the most from teachers, is the gradebook piece, that they want a change with the gradebook piece. And if we can give them one that's much more user-friendly, I think they would do it tomorrow. So I think when there's a definite need, I think they're going to be very willing to make the change, and I see that.
One more thought too.
Yeah.
I can. I think that this strategy, this plan, is strongest when it's very proactive. How can we? What are we doing well? How can we build on it? There were a few times when you talked about reacting to things out in the world, and I would, you know, as long as we live in a country with First Amendment rights,
right?
No communication plan is going to squelch rumor that's existed since before computers and will always exist. But I think if the focus is on how do we communicate more thoroughly and proactively, and I love the focus on two-way communication. So I would just, as the group gets formed and you move forward, really focus on that and kind of let the other stuff go, be my suggestion.
Very good suggestion.
Thank you.
Gary?
I would just say, this one area I think is very important is potentially protocols for parents and how it's used. For example, speaking of, we changed over in Danvers, and the middle school set up a protocol, like if you had a question about a grade, that it was responsible for the student to go to the teacher first, and then, you know, if that didn't resolve it, then the parent would get involved, so it wasn't the parent immediately. Things like that, I think, are important.
Good point.
Good. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
That was quick.
It's me.
Ready, Martha?
I'm ready. So included in your packet is an update, a financial update, as a, or it's FY16 as of January 31st. Just wanted to briefly go over some of the highlights of it. So as of January 31st, we had an unencumbered balance of just under $500,000. It's about 1.3% of our revised appropriation. So what you're seeing here is reflects all the town core being pulled out of it, which ties to the budget book that we presented back in January. So as far as the adopted FY16 budget. For comparative purposes, at this point in time last year when I updated the committee, we had $323,000 of unencumbered. So our budget is a little less because of things going over to the town core, so our percentage is a little higher and we have a little more money that's unencumbered right now. Just starting at the top and kind of going down through it, there were a number of budget transfers that were approved by the committee back on January 7th, and you'll see those reflected in the budget amendment column. The first two there, the $20,000 and $45,000, respectively. Those were to cover a leave of absence here in the Administrative Cost Center and additional expenses that we're incurring for physical employee physicals. So both of those are... The Administrative Cost Center is on track. It doesn't appear at this point that we would need another budget transfer into the Administrative Cost Center. The savings in the health center, the health services cost center, rather, I'm sorry, we had some staff turnover, which resulted in some salary savings, some anticipated savings there as well for the year. Extracurricular and athletics are on track at this point, at this time in the year. Technology, again, this is one where the committee approved a $45,000 transfer in the earlier in the year. We had some staff turnover expense in that cost center, as well as some consulting support during the transition period. And those transfers were funded by the regular ed, so you'll see the negative $65,000. That's where the transfer generated from. The last transfer that you'll see is the $100,000. That went to the town core when we divided up the revolving fund support from the FY16 budget appropriation. It was a $250,000 offset. $150,000 of it stayed with the school, and $100,000 of it went with the core. So that's what that budget transfer is. You'll also notice that the school building maintenance is right now projected in a deficit. We did have additional support during the transition time. So we had an additional staff member during the transition prior to town meeting, and town meeting approved that new position. So we're, I think they just posted for that too this week, didn't they?
They did, but yeah, that's now gonna be funded out of the town budget.
Yeah. moving into regular day, the deficits and surpluses that you see in there are due in large part to salary, to savings, turnover savings, or not, if there's a negative. The district-wide cost center, the deficit that you're seeing there, the $98,000, that's really driven by the 1.0 ELL teacher that we added. We added an additional teacher, and we do have more teacher mentor stipends because we had such a large incoming class, if you will, of new teachers and new staff members. That deficit within the regular day, some of the offsets, so we have salary savings and expenses from turnover, but we also budget for teacher retirement And this year, we budgeted for a number of retirements. We budgeted about $111,000 for retirement, and we only have three retirements this year. So there's a $72,000 surplus within the regular day as a result of fewer teacher retirements.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
I feel like I should know that, but can you explain that a little bit better? What we're budgeting for the retirements? I mean, we're budgeting because teachers are going to retire. We need substitutes, or?
No, we're budgeting for their sick leave buyback time.
We still have some teachers that are eligible for sick leave buyback.
Okay,
yeah.
So.
So each year, I look at the census of teachers and say, okay, how many do we think may or may not take it this year? Because they have until January, or I'm trying to think the deadline to let the superintendent know that they anticipate
June 30th.
So.
Is it vacation? No, vacation.
No,
it's vacation. It's sick leave buyback.
Okay.
It's been sunsetted out now.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So it will. Yes.
I believe anybody that was hired after 1996. But, so we still have some teachers that
qualify
are
for it. Yeah,
okay.
Eligible for it.
Mm-hmm.
Our special education. So moving on to our special education cost center. Right now, we're forecasting about $122,000 in unencumbered. Baked into our numbers, into our encumbered balance, Carolyn and I meet monthly, sometimes more than monthly, to review out-of-district placements and what keeping a close eye on that. And we do encumber money for students that we have either been unilaterally placed by a parent, or we think there's a very real possibility they may go out of district before the end of the year. So we have about a little more than $200,000 encumbered right now where the student may still be in our district or there's no settlement in place yet. So I think that we're in good shape with that number. We, you know, just as a reminder, we were able to prepay about $300,000 worth of tuition using FY15 funds, which really helped give us some breathing room in FY16. Mm-hmm. And, you know, just as an ongoing point, we do continue to experience an increased number of students requiring tutoring services, whether it's home or hospitalization services. Some of the deficits, one of the deficits that does jump out that I will book another journal entry to or another budget amendment to correct is between Barrows and Birch Meadow. When we developed the budget for FY16, we knew the DLC program was moving from one school to another, but we just left all the teachers where they were in FY15 and rolled them forward into FY16. And when I moved the money between buildings, I missed someone. So I need to move another salary over. So that will soften the variances, both favorable and unfavorable for Barrows and Birch. It's really a switch of personnel.
Oh, so there's an FTE out of place there, basically?
Exactly,
okay.
Exactly. Thank you. The other transfers that you see going on within there, it's staff moving, whether it's a student, whether staff resources moved because a student changed placements or changed buildings. And we do use some money from district-wide. We will move money from there to schools to help support any needs that they might have if they want to buy a certain testing protocol, mm-hmm. or there are other small needs that they might want. So there's always going to be a bit of movement between special needs, because district-wide will help fund things.
Mm-hmm.
I know you meant focused on the deficits. Mm-hmm. Actually interested in the, if you go back up to regular day, the Killam and High School, are how do they get themselves so far ahead at this
Killam
point?
I'd have to go back to look specifically. Killam.
Wood End.
I think Wood End
I'm
went
sorry,
down.
Yeah,
Wood End went down a half a teacher for kindergarten.
Yeah.
So it's not in Wood End. The 0.5 kindergarten teacher isn't in Wood End. It's somewhere else in the district. I want to say it's at. Was it at Birch Meadow?
It's at Killam.
It's at Killam. Okay. So there's a. Again, I didn't move the budget from FY16, didn't do a budget transfer to follow the person. So the person was budgeted at Wood End, and the kindergarten class is actually at Killam.
But that's not $124,000.
No, it's not, but then the different, the other part of it is gonna be salary savings from turnover.
And I guess what I, the reason why I'm looking at this is I'm, you know, we're now into, going into, to, into February or March.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, it, what looks like we're on another track to turn money back again. And a big number back, unless we're gonna be spending this $400,000. Yeah, I mean, and, you know, we get criticized for this every year. Not criticized, but it comes up every year. And how come we can never seem to spend close to budget? We're always way under, or in some instances, in deficit. I understand. I guess I understand more the deficit positions than the mm-hmm. and the.
Well, I think first of all, the budget that we have is over $40 million.
Yeah.
So when you have this difference, that's pretty good, and I'd rather have the difference in the black than in
the red. But
I think a lot of it has to do with when you hire someone. That's yeah. one piece. Because we had 19 retirements this year that we did not, when you're budgeting, you don't, when you're budgeting in November, you don't know those things are happening the next year. So that's one piece. The other piece is special ed is always I'm not blaming special ed, but special education, we do not know the needs of students.
Yeah. And special ed is actually behaving well. I'm looking more at regular
I think the, other part of it, too, is we don't necessarily know how many maternity leaves we're going to have, where the teacher is here and being paid, or maybe switching or not switching to an unpaid leave. So while they're here, we're paying for a long-term sub at $125
which
a day.
Which is much cheaper.
But they may take the 12 weeks and then come back, so we incurred both expense and didn't have any savings on the back end. So it's really, I appreciate your comment. It is a challenge to try and budget and not, but I'm with Dr. Doherty. I'd rather have it be
yeah,
a positive
I know it's
than
a
negative.
One, I know when the, so, in the order of magnitude, we're looking at 1% here,
right.
but $400,000 is
right,
a,
but we're
a
in
lot
February.
Of
Yeah,
I understand, but I think, you know, all right, so we'll have, hopefully we're not having this conversation in June that we didn't, we had 400,000 we didn't need, or we didn't spend, I should say.
Right. As Mrs. Seibert said, a lot of this is dependent upon what's going on with staff. And last year, we had five teachers out for the entire year mm-hmm. for illness. Okay, this year, thankfully,
it's far fewer.
So those are things that are variables we can't control. A lot of what you're seeing, this ebb and flow, is all personnel driven.
Well, that's most of what.
And it really has to do with what is going on with different staff. You know, when we don't know how many staff are going to be going out on maternity leave, we budget in a number, and sometimes we hit that number right on, and other times we're under, and other times we're over. Sometimes teachers say they're coming back in 12 weeks, and then they say, oh, I want 12 more weeks.
Yeah.
Well, those are unpaid.
Mm-hmm.
So that means that we're hiring a person at a much lower rate, because now they're getting $125 a day versus whatever the teacher salary is. Then that teacher says, oh, you know what, I'm going to take the rest of the year off. And that's happened a few times this year.
That has happened a couple
so
times this year.
So that adds up in the positive from a budgetary standpoint. So those are the things that go on that we can't control.
Yes.
Could supplies and materials be impacting that? Isn't there a lot of purchasing at the end of the fiscal year?
When I do my forecast, I forecast out that the schools are going to spend every penny that they have, because they do every year.
Yeah.
So this really, the variances that you're seeing here are really in the personnel.
Personnel.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
And special education.
Yes. Yes, sorry. Thank you.
Ms. Webb.
So can I just, on that, say, for instance, in the regular day that you've got the $98,000 deficit at district wide, which you said was really related to the one
the ELL teacher,
mm-hmm. but that teacher is supporting across the elementary.
Mm-hmm.
Is that
whole,
where that
whole district?
The whole district.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Right. So And you're just saying in terms of, you know, whether you've sort of moved that half a teacher, but you wouldn't distribute that teacher up by,
right,
you know, 0.2 for every, that just doesn't make sense.
No, it doesn't make sense. And I don't necessarily move the budget around to make the variances go away. You know, the variances are explainable.
To understand make sure we're understanding what they are, what's driving and.
You know, there is one more thing that we did not mention that has happened several times this year, not necessarily with teachers, but with paraeducators, is unfilled positions.
Mm-hmm.
So we have had special education paraeducators and regular education paraeducators where the positions have been unfilled for months. So there's been no one in that position, which also is a positive impact on the budget.
So, Mr. Nyman?
Yes. So one question I would have about this in terms of setting up the budget, is it feasible to have like an administrative reserve amount so that we'd be closer? You know, I mean, I've seen districts where, I'm just gonna throw out $100,000 as an administrative reserve for things that are, you know, unexpected, or maybe you hire somebody at a higher rate than you thought, or somebody goes out on leave and, you know, it's a Family Leave Act or something like that. I know there's districts that do it, but I don't know exactly how it's set up and how they gauge it. But I think in the big picture, at the end of the year, if you had money left over in this administrative reserve, it would probably look different than, you know, it does when you come to the end of the school year and you just see a one big budget that, you know, we have $500,000 left over or something like that.
Yeah, I do know some districts that do budget reserves for various unanticipated events. We don't do that. I have worked other places where you budget for dark time, and I think that on the town side they might do a little bit of budgeting for dark time where a position is unfilled, but most of our positions have to be filled. We have to have teachers in the classroom, and that's just a huge percentage of what our workforce is. So I think we keep in mind, Dr. Doherty and I, that typically we have gains when there is staff turnover, because we don't typically go out and replace someone who's at the top end of the pay scale, who's been here forever, not forever, but who's you know, a master's 13. We don't necessarily replace them with a master's 13. So we typically do have salary savings, which would in effect be a reserve.
Well, I think the salary savings that we see is more at the elementary level. Very rarely do we see. When you are for middle and high school, you don't see that.
Yeah.
Oh, not now.
So yeah, I mean, I didn't mean to beat this, but
no, they're all
the actual.
No, I'd rather have this discussion.
Your last comment was
solve a deficit.
Your last comment was actually, you know, that's important, that the fact that there are positions that have yet to be filled, because that's a legitimate reason why we're not spending the money. I was more concerned that we, you know, weren't doing things or we were asking for too much.
No, we're doing things, and then sometimes the positions are left unfilled and we can't fill them. And that's happened, mostly with paraeducators.
Yeah.
Not necessarily with teachers.
And I guess just one final thing that from me anyway, maybe, and it's not for solving tonight, but maybe it's something we talk about later or offline, or to maybe try and keep track of, you know, when we do make advances because of a personnel change or whatever, and all of a sudden maybe we can have those discussions about doing things that we couldn't do when we were projecting another way, and now we're going. So just ways to redeploy that money within the budget. I know that was kind of vague, but
I understand.
Yes.
So I guess it sounds like too, though, the as well as sort of the unfilled positions, that the issue sort of with leaves being extended unanticipatedly creates a pretty decent variance because of the substitute. So I know we've talked about the budget impacts, that positive impacts the budgets. Certainly, it's not our preference because
no.
we want to have the teachers there for students. We want to have the full-time teachers. You know, we would like those teachers to return. The students probably want the teachers to return, but we've got, you know, we have to, you know, honor what they're allowed to do and what their preference is. Mm-hmm. And but, you know, I guess oftentimes that may mean then at the end of the year, if that teacher's not coming back, then you know you're hiring another teacher. But I suppose that can sort of keep rolling, it sounds like, without being able to take the step that I think Chuck was just alluding to. It's like, you know, where's that point where you could say you could take a step? In these mm-hmm. cases, you can't because it's 12 weeks later.
Well, we can't predict.
Right, yeah.
When a teacher says they have every intention of coming back,
right.
and then they say, no, I'm not coming back.
Right, and they totally, I've been there. They might, they really might intend to, and then something
right.
changes. Yeah. So.
Thank you, Martha.
Thank you.
Talk about the Birch Meadow search timeline.
Yes, so in your packet is the timeline for the Birch. I think I've talked a lot about this already. So what you see there is the screening committee. Mr. Sprung and Mrs. Wilson are going to be the administrators along with Saunders. And then we have a mix of staff and parents. We did try to balance all of the different stakeholders. We do have a representative from the CPAC on here. As well as parents from different grade levels, so that we could balance K to 5 representation, and same with teachers. We have a K and a 4 representation, and special education representation for teachers. And you could see the timeline. And you know, the goal would be to have by the end of March, at the very latest, early April, a principal hired.
Your motion.
Yes, Mr. Chair, move to approve the Birch Meadow principal search process and timeline as presented.
Second. Any other discussion?
I just had a question about the two new principal positions. You know, hopefully you're going to be able to announce these in March or April. And then typically, or what's your expectation for these two people to come on board? Like July 1, June 1?
July 1.
July 1, okay.
Yep. All those in favor?
5-0.
Minutes.
That was in the consent agenda.
Oh, I'm sorry. Yep. Yes.
Can you just clarify? You said the open mic night for the Parker principal is the 29th.
Next Monday.
Next Monday at 6:30.
Is the first would be the first person. Yes.
Oh, that's dirty.
There'll be 30 minutes for each candidate.
At Park.
Correct. The auditorium.
Okay. Thank you.
Do you have a motion?
Yes, Mr. Chair, move to enter into executive session to discuss strategy with respect to possible litigation, collective bargaining, and the approval of minutes, and not to return to open session.
Is there a second?
Second.
Mr. Nyan?
Yes.
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 Yes. Thanks, Carl and Alex.